Thermoplastic, an extremely durable pavement marking material. When it's applied correctly, thermo can last for years. Thermoplastic pavement markings are especially good at retaining their retroreflectivity. That's the ability to reflect light from a vehicle's headlamps back to the driver. On a dark stretch of road, bright pavement markings can be real lifesavers. But as good as it is, thermoplastic will perform well only when it's applied correctly and in the right road and weather conditions. And that's where you come in. As the construction inspector, it's your responsibility to see that the contractor uses approved materials and equipment, and that the markings are placed in accordance with the project plans, specs, and special provisions. This program on inspecting the installation of thermoplastic pavement markings will show you what to look for. The first thing we'll look at is the materials and equipment used in thermoplastic applications. Then, we'll briefly discuss a few general responsibilities of the pavement marking inspector. And finally, we'll look at 10 inspection points that can help produce high-quality, long-lasting pavement markings. We'll also point out a few troubleshooting tips to help you and the contractor resolve some common application problems. Okay, let's start with a look at the materials and equipment. Without getting too deeply into the chemistry of it, thermoplastic pavement markings basically consist of four ingredients: pigment for color, fillers to give it bulk, and resins to bind it all together. Tiny glass beads are added to the mixture to provide the light reflecting ability good pavement markings require. During the marking operation, a mechanical dispenser drops additional glass beads directly on the top of the line. These drop-on beads give the line its initial retroreflectivity. As they wear down, the mixed-in beads will take over. When thermo comes to the job site, it's in solid form. It has to be heated and agitated to melt and blend the ingredients. Complete heating and blending are the critical factors in thermoplastic preparation. One reason thermo is such a good pavement marking material is the quality of the bond it forms with the road surface, especially asphalt. Because of its high application temperature, thermo actually fuses with the asphalt, creating what engineers refer to as thermal bond. On Portland cement concrete pavements, thermo doesn't actually fuse with the road surface. Instead, it fills up the tiny voids in the surface and bonds to the road through friction. When thermo is used on concrete, the contractor should apply an approved primer or sealer to the application area before he puts down the marking. The primer will help the thermoplastic adhere better to the road surface. As for application equipment, there are a variety of manufacturers and styles. Truck-mounted equipment is typically used on long-line projects. These larger units will usually have heating and agitating kettles on board. Smaller jobs can be handled by more portable equipment. But no matter what the size or equipment style, all models must be able to keep the material at the recommended temperature throughout the marking operation. Not keeping the material hot is a common cause of thermoplastic failure. Another important feature of thermoplastic application equipment is the dispensing device, the part that actually applies the material to the road. There are three basic types of dispensing devices: spray, screed extrusion, and ribbon extrusion. Spray devices use air pressure to atomize the hot thermo and shoot it down onto the road. Screed and ribbon extrusion devices extrude or squeeze the thermoplastic through a die or shoe, which shapes the material to a specified width and thickness. Okay, that's a quick look at thermoplastic and the application equipment. Now let's go over a few general responsibilities of the pavement marking inspector. First off, you have to know your references. Part 3 of the Manual on Uniform Traffic Control Devices is a good place to start. It focuses specifically on pavement marking standards and provides general guidelines to follow on most applications. You should also be familiar with all other documents that govern the marking operation, including the layout and general plans, any special provisions, and the appropriate sections of the standard specifications. In addition, you should review the project's traffic control requirements. The safe maintenance of traffic and the protection of the work crew are every bit as important as getting the lines down in the first place. Ideally, the inspector should take part in any pre-construction conference to go over the job's requirements. Among the items that should be discussed between the contractor and the project engineering staff are the materials to be used, specifically the type of thermoplastic, glass beads, and primer or sealant, all sampling, testing, and approval requirements, type of equipment to be used, weather and temperature restrictions, the method of measurement and basis for payment, and other issues that could affect the outcome of the project. The important thing is that you and the contractor share an understanding of what is required before any pavement marking work begins. As inspector, you have the responsibility to notify the contractor when you spot problems. It's unfair to wait because any deviation from the plans may have to be corrected. That could mean removing and reapplying a whole new set of markings, and that gets expensive. On the other hand, you're not there to tell the contractor how to do his job. You're there mainly to see that he uses the right materials and produces pavement markings that meet the requirements of the contract. As long as he meets those conditions, and short of any serious safety violations, you should allow the operation to continue. Finally, one of your most important duties as inspector is documentation. Thorough documentation of the materials used, the work performed, and the road and weather conditions provides a written record that can be used to assure accurate payment to the contractor or to show why the payment should be adjusted. Okay, that takes care of your general responsibilities. Now let's get specific and look at 10 inspection points to follow on every thermoplastic marking project. Inspection number one, the materials and equipment. Make sure that the contractor uses only approved materials, namely the thermoplastic itself, the drop-on beads, and any primer or sealer that might be required for the applications on concrete. Check material certification, cross-reference batch numbers, and obtain material samples according to your agency's sampling and acceptance procedures. As for equipment, the plans or specs will often specify which type of equipment and dispensing device should be used. Make sure the contractor's equipment meets the requirements of the job. The second inspection point is the temperature of the air and road surface. Use a road surface thermometer to see if the temperature is up to that required by the specs or by the thermoplastic manufacturer. Applying thermo when the road or air temperature is too cold will just about guarantee a poor bond to the pavement. Record the temperature at the time of the application. In general, thermoplastic should be applied when the road and air temperatures are 50 to 55 degrees and rising. The specific temperature requirements may vary according to the manufacturer and the type of equipment used. Factors such as wind chill, the degree of sunshine versus cloudiness, and so on should be considered. Again, check the manufacturer's recommendations. Now, inspection point number three, the condition of the road surface. For the thermoplastic to bond well to the pavement, the road surface has to be clean and dry. A thorough sweeping of the pavement is a good idea if it has been exposed to the elements for some time. To get a good bond on concrete, the contractor must also remove curing compound from all areas to be marked. And remember that concrete surfaces also must be primed or sealed before the thermoplastics applied. In addition to being clean, the road must also be completely dry. Here's an easy test for moisture. Lay a piece of cardboard or roofing paper on the road and apply a short stripe. If there's moisture on the road, it'll show up on the underside of the paper. The fourth inspection point is checking the layout and pre-markings. This inspection simply involves checking the pre-markings against the plans. Let the contractor know if you spot any discrepancies. Remember that edge lines and center lines are typically offset at least 2 inches from longitudinal joints. Now the fifth point, material preparation. As we saw earlier, thermoplastic must be heated and stirred or agitated to prepare it for use. In general, thermoplastic should be heated from 400 to 440 degrees Fahrenheit for application on bituminous or concrete surfaces. Again, the best bet is to go with the manufacturer's recommendations. Keep in mind, however, that a hotter road surface may permit lower application temperatures and vice versa. Applying thermoplastic when its temperature is too low causes poor bonding to the pavement. Temperatures that are too high may scorch the material, causing discoloration, brittleness, and generally poor performance. To ensure proper heating, check all material temperature gauges against a calibrated thermometer for accuracy. You should also occasionally check the material temperature as it enters the dispensing device. An infrared-type thermometer works best. Thermo can cool off significantly from the time it leaves the kettle to the time it actually reaches the road. In addition to checking temperature, you should also be looking for thorough blending of the thermoplastic ingredients. Any equipment with more than a 250-pound capacity should be equipped with motorized agitators. If the material is being transferred to a smaller unit, look for a uniform consistency of the material during the transfer. The contractor should use a screen to filter out foreign matter. Now the sixth inspection point. Checking marking alignment, color, width, and uniformity. As the work progresses, look closely at the quality of the line. The application should follow the pre-marks closely. The edges of the line should be crisp and well-defined. Make sure you're getting the correct color of marking. Once the material cools, use a color tolerance chart or other device to check the line color. If the color is off, it could be due to material overheating or to inadequate cleaning of the equipment when a new color was added. Measure the width of the line. 4 inches is typical for edge and center lines. Wider lines are used for increased emphasis in hazardous areas. Check the plans for all line widths. In addition to checking alignment, width, and color, you should also be looking for a uniform application so that you get a consistent line profile and cross-section. Ideally, the line will be rectangular. That is, it should be flat on top and have vertical sides with the same thickness all the way across. Different dispensing devices will show different problems. Here are a few of the most common. Spray devices will often produce a rounded or humped line cross-section, high in the middle, lower at the edges, usually due to incorrect setting of the spray nozzles. Again, you want to see a flat line with vertical sides and uniform width and thickness. Another common problem with spray devices is excessive overspray, anything that detracts from the appearance of a neat line. Again, it's usually due to incorrect nozzle settings. A small amount of overspray, however, is practically unavoidable and will usually disappear once traffic hits it. On screed extrusion applications, look out for rough or pitted lines. That may indicate stones or other objects are caught in the extrusion shoe. Ribbon extrusion devices often appear to be stretching the material. That happens when the material is being applied too cool, too thin, or at too fast an application speed. Okay, now the seventh inspection point, the tape test to check material bond, thickness, and drop-on bead embedment. If an inspector had to perform just one test, this is it. The tape test provides the best measure of pavement marking quality. Here's how it's done. Place several pieces of tape across the path of the striper. Use black duct tape on the bituminous pavements and masking tape on concrete. They'll blend in better with the pavement colors. After the striper passes, allow time for the material to cool completely. Then go back and remove the tape by scoring the line with a penknife. Try to peel back the exposed ends of the line. If there's a good bond, you'll see aggregate and asphalt sticking to the bottom of the line. On concrete, a good bond is indicated if the material chips off as you try to peel it back. Poor bonding to the pavement can be caused by a number of factors. The most common are the air, road surface, or material temperatures are too cool. The road surface is damp or dirty. Material placed on damp pavement will bubble and peel easily. Poor bonding can also be due to applying the material too thin. If you notice any of these conditions, notify the contractor immediately and document his response. To check material thickness, simply measure the thickness of your sample on the tape at both edges and in the center. Record the average thickness, but don't forget to subtract the thickness of the tape from your results. The thickness of the marking must be at least the minimum specified in the specs or plans. If it's not, tell the contractor. The most common causes of inadequate material thickness are incorrect equipment settings. The contractor may have to adjust the setting of the spray device or extrusion shoe. Another reason for inadequate thickness is that the application speed is too fast. The faster the speed, the thinner the material will be applied. The striper operator should maintain a constant speed that produces the specified thickness. You can also measure in-place thickness with a special type of micrometer. This machine calculates the thickness of the material on the pavement electronically. For accurate results, take at least 5 readings at each test location. Finally, material thickness can be calculated using standard formulas that take into account line width, linear feet covered, and pounds of material used. It's important that the contractor applies thermoplastic at the correct thickness for 2 reasons. First, a thicker line lasts longer. It's simply more durable than a thin line. Second, if the contractor applies the line too thin, he gets paid for more material than he actually used. Both ways, the department and the public get shortchanged. In addition to bond and thickness tests, you should also check the embedment and distribution of the drop-on beads. Ideally, 60% of the bead surface will be embedded in the material. That's enough to anchor them to the line and still provide the required retroreflection. Check bead distribution by brushing away loose beads from the surface. Look for uneven or pulsing patterns. That indicates a problem with the bead dispenser. Other bead application problems can be caused by moisture or excessive wind. Stand with your back to the sun so that you cast a shadow over or near the edge of the line. A line with a good distribution and sufficient number of beads will appear dull. The application rate for drop-on beads is usually specified as so many pounds of beads per 100 square feet. Check the specs or plans for the bead application rate and how it's to be measured and paid for. Okay, now inspection point number 8, retroreflectivity. If your agency has a retroreflectometer, use it to take objective measurements of the pavement marking's brightness. Be sure to follow the manufacturer's directions. They can vary from one instrument to another. Record your measurements and check them against the specified requirements. The real test of any pavement marking, though, is how well it shows up at night. Drive the entire length of the project at night and look closely at the markings. You should be able to see them up to the limits of your headlights, both high and low beams. The 9th inspection point can be called post-application observation. Some highway agencies require an observation period of up to 180 days prior to the final acceptance of pavement markings. During this period, you or another inspector should periodically review the quality of the markings. Daytime inspections are okay for spotting bond failures or alignment problems, but nighttime reviews are the best way of checking overall marking performance. The 10th inspection point has already been mentioned, but it's worth repeating. Documentation. You should record all items that can affect the quality of the pavement markings. Materials used, weather conditions, equipment problems, and test results are just a few of the items to include. Thorough documentation is the best way to protect the interests of the department and the contractor, and to assure good pavement marking performance. Let's quickly review the 10 inspection points. First, verify material inspection, approval, or certification. The contractor's equipment should match the job requirements. Next, the road and air temperatures. They should meet or exceed those recommended by the thermoplastic manufacturer or those specified in the plans or specs. Make sure the road surface is properly prepared. No moisture, dirt, solvent, oil, or other condition that could interfere with a good bond. The contractor's layout and pre-marking should be complete and in close conformance to the plans. Material temperature should be within the manufacturer's recommended range before the contractor begins application. The material must be thoroughly mixed. As the work begins, check the marking alignment, width, color, and uniformity. Notify the contractor of any problems immediately. Use the tape test or other means to check marking bond, thickness, and bead distribution. Perform day and night inspections for retroreflectivity. Follow up the project with periodic inspections throughout any required post-application observation period. And finally, Document all items related to the project. As you've seen, there's a lot more to inspection of pavement markings than watching someone draw a line down the road. The equipment, materials, and work methods required to do a good job are complex and difficult to master, but it's worth it. While pavement marking might represent a small fraction of a project's budget, few other construction items have such a direct impact on public safety. Drivers rely on those lines and markings to guide them. That means, of course, that they are relying on you. Through careful inspection, you show them the way, safely. For additional information and training materials on thermoplastic and other pavement marking material, contact the American Traffic Safety Services Association, ATSA, at 5440 Jefferson Davis Highway, Fredericksburg, Virginia, 22401. Or call us at 703-898-5400.